The National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated stations present The Pacific Story. This is the story of the Pacific, the drama of the millions of people who live around this greatest sea, where the United States is now committed to a long-term policy of keeping the peace. This is a documentary account of the situation in the Pacific, of the men and events which are today influencing the shape of world affairs for generations to come. Post-war Formosa. Afternoon on October 24th, 1945, a huge air transport approached for a landing at Taipei Airport in northern Formosa. Thousands waited to meet it. But not all the eyes were on the approaching plane. Many were on General Rikiyohi Ando, commander of the Japanese 10th Area Army, and on the 20 other Japanese officials. General Chen Yi and his staff were coming in on this plane to take over the government of Formosa in the name of the Republic of China. Were brief. Japanese soldiers, standing like ramrods, stared straight into space as General Chen disembarked from the plane. There was a stiff formal greeting from General Ando, a cold military response from General Chen. This was the end of 50 years of Japanese occupation of Formosa. Only a few among the thousands at the airport remembered when the Japanese took over Formosa 50 years before.
We could not believe it had happened.
This old one remembered.
The word came that China had been defeated by Japan, and that now Formosa was to go under Japanese rule.
Do you remember when the Japanese came to take over the island, old one?
I was a young man, too young to understand all that was happening. But I remember that we were told to resist the Japanese. And we did. We refused to go under the rule of the Japanese.
And they landed troops?
Yes, they landed troops. But even these were not enough to hold us down at the time Formosa was handed over to the Japanese. So the ceremonies were held on a Japanese warship at sea. And that happened just off the port of Keelung, only 18 miles from Taipei, here. Yes, and now here are the Japanese handing Formosa back to us. But there were many bad years between. Many bad years.
The old one kept his eyes on the Japanese. He had many things to remember. And then all eyes turned to General Chen Yi, who was talking into a microphone, broadcasting to the people of Formosa.
I have come to serve you people of Formosa, to help you. There will be three guiding principles in my policy. First, there will be no interruption of business. Second, there will be no immediate interruption of political administration. And third, there will be no interruption of education in schools. My main objective will be to raise the standard of living. I will work to eliminate unemployment, and I will place special emphasis on education. It is my hope that all Formosans will be taught to speak and write Chinese within 4 years, so that you may participate in the reconstruction of China.
The Formosans who listened muttered to one another under their breaths. And the old one solemnly shook his head.
Most of these people know little of China. They have been under the Japanese so long. They know little of Sun Yat-sen or the Chinese Revolution. For most of them were born under the Japanese rule and have spent all their lives under the Japanese rule.
General Chen Yi and his staff got into the waiting limousines. They pulled away and headed for Taipei, to the seat of the Japanese Governor General's office to take over the government of Formosa. And the old one stood solemnly and shook his head,
while those around him talked.
Why should we be under China any more than we should be under Japan?
Formosa belonged to China before the Japanese came in 1894.
But never in my lifetime has Formosa been part of China.
We are of Chinese blood.
94% of the people of Formosa have Chinese blood, yes. But the last ties we had with China were generations ago.
China is our motherland.
But the people who come here to rule us are strangers.
The ancestors of most of Formosa's 6 million persons had immigrated to Formosa. They had crossed the 90-mile strait from the mainland of China to make their homes and seek their fortunes on the great island. From Fujian province had come the people called the Hok Lo. From the backwoods of Guangdong province had come the people called the Hakka. From Canton had come merchants and tradespeople. They met the half-wild aborigines who lived in the eastern highlands. These were the people who lived on the island when the Portuguese came and named the island Ilha Formosa, Beautiful Island. Long before the Japanese took Formosa from China 50 years ago, they knew all about the island. The Japanese and the Chinese called the island Taiwan, which means Terraced Bay.
Now, look at this map here on the table. The length of the entire island from north to south is about 220 miles. And its greatest width here is about 80 miles.
Yes. And what is the distance from the southern tip of Taiwan to Luzon in the Philippines?
A distance of about 225 miles.
Mm-hmm.
You see, there are no harbors on the east coast. The mountains come right down to the sea all along the eastern side. Here. Some of the cliffs are 6,000 feet high.
6,000 feet?
Yes, right along here.
Hmm. Where then are the harbors?
There is one up here in the north. The best one. It is named Kirun. Right here.
Mm-hmm. I have heard Kirun is very limited in capacity.
That is right. But still it is better than the other harbor in the south, Takao. You see, Kirun here has an inner harbor, which is a safe anchorage from typhoons.
Well, Kirun could be developed into a better harbor, could it not?
Oh, it would be a great task. And now down here on the southwest coast here is Takao. This harbor could be made into a...
The Japanese knew not only the geography of the island, they also knew its resources.
About 65% of the island is covered with green forests of camphor, cypress, rattan and bamboo. The forests cover all these regions here and here. And there is gold here and here. And copper in this region and up here. And coal over here and here. And in addition, there is...
And they took note of Formosa's two main crops, sugar and rice. The Japanese knew all this before they went to war with the Chinese 50 years ago. But they had not counted on the resistance they would meet when they came to take over the island.
Down with the Japanese! Independence for Taiwan!
Japanese!
Down with the invaders!
For the Taiwan Republic!
Many were killed, but we defied the Japanese anyway. Our leaders set up a republic, and all of us worked to support it against the Japanese. They brought in more and more soldiers. We had almost no weapons and ammunition. At last, they put us down. Even so, we continued to resist.
The resistance of the Formosans continued. But in the face of the increasing Japanese pressure against every phase of their Chinese life, the resistance gradually faded. Also, with the passing of many of the older firebrands, those who had defied the Japanese troops and set up the Formosan Republic, and with the growing up of the younger Formosans under the Japanese, the Formosans no longer saw eye to eye with the people of China. Chinese they were by blood and sympathy. But against them, the Japanese leveled remorseless Japanization measures.
They have prohibited our last Chinese newspaper.
That is because Japan is now at war with China.
This was 1937.
But we outnumber the Japanese 18-1 on this island. We should at least have the right to newspapers in our own language.
How long has it been since any Chinese have immigrated here from the mainland?
The Japanese have not permitted free immigration of Chinese.
That is right. Formosa is no longer a Chinese island.
It is a Chinese island. Rightfully, it belongs to China.
But what do we have in common with the people of China?
What do we have in common with the Japanese?
The Japanese are here. They have been here since long before we were born. I am not for the Japanese, But we are far from Chinese now.
We are still Chinese. We should have the right to our own newspaper.
My friend, China is at war with Japan.
Long before the outbreak of the war between Japan and China in 1937, the Japanese had come to regard its colonies as instruments of war, not merely as economic areas. They converted Formosa into a mighty military and naval outpost. Heilung in the north and Takao in the southwest, they developed into great ports to handle men and materiel of war. They conceived of Formosa not only as an impregnable base, but also as a giant unsinkable aircraft carrier. Military airfields sprouted from one end of the island to the other. The Japanese stepped up their Japanization measures.
It is therefore with great happiness that we announce the organization of the Imperial Subject Loyalty Society. Through this society, many good things will come to those who have mastered the Japanese language. Also, there will be special rewards for those who take Japanese names in order that all the people of Taiwan can become Japanese and enjoy the benefits of being Japanese. It is the purpose of the Imperial Subject Loyalty Society to encourage one and all in the imperial way. With this great movement, it will be to the advantage of all the...
The effect of the Imperial Subject movement was apparent everywhere.
Oh, Yet Lo. I hardly knew you.
My name is not Yet Lo, old one.
No?
My name is Kinjiri Okuda.
Oh.
Every sensible Formosan should change his name.
Oh, it is very late in my life.
It is never too late.
Oh, yes. You wear Japanese-style clothes, too, Yet Lo.
These are the proper clothes. They have been designated by the government for us.
What government?
The only government we have. And if you will take my advice, old one, you will not wear that long gown.
Oh, I have worn long gowns all the days of my life.
They are forbidden.
Well, they cannot mean it.
They do mean it. You are wise. You are wearing the straw sandals. Why do you not also wear these kind of clothes?
Well, there are no other kind of sandals. All the leather has been taken by the Japanese.
Japan is at war.
Yes. What rewards will you get for changing your name and your clothes?
Many things. I will get better food and more food. I will get priority in ship and railway tickets. But most important of all, I will get equal status with the Japanese.
Oh, yes. Yes, I see, Yet Lo. Oh, Kinjiri Okuda. Good day to you. Good day.
On the surface, it seemed that many had thus become loyal subjects of the emperor. But actually, little more than 1% of the Chinese of Formosa changed their names and adopted the Japanese manners.
Loyal subjects. Fool. So, the Japanese want to treat you as an equal. An equal of what? A pig?
They will keep their word. They have said so.
What have you gained by turning Japanese?
You will see in time. The time will come
loyal
when you...
subjects. Fool.
The Japanese went still further. They set up a strong organization to enforce the loyal subject movement.
All phases of Formosan life will be directed. In the central office of the Imperial Subject Loyalty Society, there will be 6 boards. One will have charge of local affairs. One will have charge of daily life. One economic affairs. One production. One supply. And one trading. Offices will be set up in all phases.
100 centers were set up to train Formosans to be loyal subjects. In the next several years, 450,000 Formosans were encouraged to join.
They trained the young men, and even though many young men tried to resist the training, most of them at last were indoctrinated with the Japanese ways. And some of these young men even became economic spies for the Japanese against their own people.
2 crops of rice are now planted on the land each year. With this plan, the farmers could be made to produce also a crop of wheat.
The secret agents kept an eye on every step of the rice industry.
I certify that the full quota of rice is aboard this vessel for Japan.
They saw to it that half of Formosa's rice went to Japan. And they kept an eye on Formosa's sugar industry. With their help, the Japanese made Formosa the fourth most important sugar production center in the world. The 50 sugar refineries of Formosa were brought under the control of four Japanese companies. Less than 1% of the total capital of the four companies was owned by Formosans. And these mills turned out not only enough sugar to supply all of Japan's needs, but also enough to export throughout the Western Pacific and the Far East. Half of the sugar mills were equipped to distill alcohol, which was to have 100 uses during the coming war. The sugar mills became war plants. The Formosans were put to work producing coal, aluminum, petroleum, and gold. But despite the stringent Japanese indoctrination, not all Formosans worked for the Japanese.
Yes, sir. The troops under my command were on guard at the mine. The explosion went off in the main shaft 10 minutes after the rash workman had left.
Have you arrested any suspects?
Yes, sir. See?
Formosan?
Yes, sir. I think they are revolutionists.
Not one Formosan was around when the fire started.
Who else would set fire to an oil field?
I have questioned everyone.
It is sabotage.
The first I saw of it was when the fire broke out on well number 706.
It was done by the underground. Arrest every Formosan who has been in the...
This is the same kind of wreck as the one last week.
It was done by the same criminal.
The entire right-of-way has been under guard.
The track was torn up during the night.
If the track was torn up, our guards would have heard.
The track was torn up.
It must have been done by those Formosan rebels. They seem to be everywhere.
The Formosan underground grew stronger as the war went on. Those who were half-hearted took new courage from the bold acts of sabotage. Underground bands formed throughout the islands and harassed the Japanese at every turn. The Formosans who had turned Japanese worked their way into the underground organization and betrayed the leaders. But the Formosans who refused to turn Japanese welded themselves into a strong anti-Japanese organization.
Here, then, are our objectives. First, to cripple the production and transportation of Taiwan, as we have done with mines, oil fields, and railroads. Second, to strengthen all anti-Japanese guerrilla forces on the island. Third, to organize volunteers to fight in China against the Japanese. Fourth, to win the support of workers, municipal employees, and students throughout the island against the Japanese. And fifth, to spread anti-war and anti-fascist propaganda. And sixth, to unite all organizations resisting the Japanese in Taiwan.
By 1941, the Japanese were drafting the Formosans into their army.
They drafted the men of Taiwan, but they did not trust them. They permitted only small numbers of Formosans to be in any one unit, and they always put them with Japanese troops. But they took them and they trained them in the Japanese ways and customs and weaned them away from China.
The Japanese armed Formosa until it bristled from Keelung in the north to Takao in the southwest to the southernmost tip of the island. War equipment and personnel in enormous quantity piled up. Thousands of troops poised for battle. Vessels filled the ports. Warships, auxiliaries, transports, cargo carriers. Formosa became a springboard to the south. The ships loaded with fighting men and all that fighting men need fanned out of the harbors and started Japan's drive to the south.
There are enough Japanese troops on Taiwan to kill every one of us.
We must lie low.
They have taken the Philippines and Malaya and Singapore and the islands of the Dutch Indies, and
they will be stopped and thrown back. Mark my words.
We will not live to see it.
Nearly 2 years passed before the underground of Formosa saw the first evidence of help.
American planes! Run!
United States Army Air Force planes based in China blasted the air bases of Formosa, and the half-hearted Formosans took courage. The underground grew stronger, and out of Formosa came the words of Xie Nang Kuang, the leader of the Formosan Revolutionary League.
We are continuing the fight. The Japanese have forced us to take Japanese names, to handle Japanese machines, and to join Japanese organizations. But we are still resisting. When the Allied troops land on Formosa, They will not find an unfriendly country.
Before another year had passed, Formosa was being struck from both land and sea.
U.S. carrier-based planes have again struck Formosa, wrecking harbor installations and sinking not only the Japanese ships in the harbor, but the shipping as far as 100 miles out of Formosa. The latest carrier strike was made this morning at dawn. Cube reports of the U.S. Air Force based in China again today hit the air bases, warehouses, and ammunition dumps on Formosa. Hardest blows were delivered against Shinjuku, which is not only an air base, but an important railway city. Spokesmen for the Air Force say that less resistance is out.
The Allied pressure against Formosa did not let up until the surrender of Japan. Formosa passed from the hands of the Japanese back to the hands of the Chinese, into the hands of General Chen Yi. But the Japanese did not turn back the same island they had taken 50 years before. They turned back a bomb-blasted citadel, richer in terms of industrial development, but poorer in terms of Chinese fealty.
It will be my policy to improve the livelihood of you, the people of Taiwan.
General Chen Yi made a public statement 5 days after he and his staff arrived.
It will be my policy to reestablish Chinese newspapers and other organs of public opinion in Taiwan. I will put special emphasis on education, for although many of you have lived under the Japanese most of your lives, you are still Chinese.
It will do no good.
What are you saying?
I say it will do no good. We are not Chinese. We are Formosan.
Formosa belongs to China.
Ha! Does he think that this memorial service for Dr. Sun Yat-sen here today will make us Chinese?
China is your motherland and mine.
The next day, the Formosans stood by in Taipei and watched the Chinese take over the Japanese governor's administration. They watched Chinese from the mainland move in to take the place of the Japanese. They stood by passively. And the old one shook his head.
It will take a long time, a long, long time, before the people of Formosa regard the mainland Chinese as anything but strangers.
A week later, Chinese troops landed at the port of Takao in the south. And the Formosans stood by and watched them, as they had watched the officials who preceded them. Step by step, the mainland Chinese took over the administration. The higher officials sent the lesser officials out into the localities to make contact with the Formosans.
I am to be the head of your CM.
The province of Formosa was divided into 8 CN, or county districts.
We have come to help you. The Japanese who have been over you all these years will be sent back to Japan as soon as we can get shipping to move them.
The Japanese have run everything. The stores, the banks, the farms.
It is not our purpose to interfere with business, but the Japanese must go.
Yes.
We will start to revive Taiwan's agriculture at once. Then there will be enough rice for everyone.
The crop failed last year.
There will be a shortage for a time, but when we get the unemployed back at work, there will be food for all.
What of all the Formosans that were taken to Japan in labor gangs who are now coming back? Where will they work?
General Chen Yi has said we will try to find work for everyone. We will need many workers in the mines. During the war, the production of coal dropped from 200,000 tons a month to only 15,000 tons a month. And when we get more coal, then the other industries will be able to operate. And when these operate...
Chinese experts came from the mainland to put Formosa's industry back on its feet. They brought in American experts. They found the larger plants and mines in ruins. Enormous outlays would have to be made before they could be put back in operation. Until the power plants, the aluminum, cement, and paper plants, the oil fields, the copper mines were back in operation, Formosa's economy would be crippled. To darken the picture, the Formosans were hungry.
Right!
We demand rice! We were not hungry under the Japanese!
Yes, give us rice!
Quiet! Quiet, then I will tell you!
Quiet! Let the Chinese talk!
As you know, Taiwan usually has plenty of rice. For years, 16 million pukuls of rice were produced by you people on this island each year. Of this, 4 million pickles were exported to Japan. But last year, your crop failed. You raised only 50% of your normal production. And still, rice was exported to Japan. That is why there is a shortage of rice here on Formosa today.
I can tell you another reason there is a shortage.
The hoarding and smuggling of rice. Yes. Why don't you Chinese put a stop to that?
Added to the rice shortage was the trouble with sugar. The four Japanese sugar companies controlling some 50 sugar refineries were merged by the Chinese. The Taiwan Sugar Corporation, a Chinese government combine, took over the sugar industry lock, stock, and barrel, controlled the production, sale, and export of Formosa sugar. The government sugar corporation controlled not only the sugar that was shipped to Shanghai, but also the sugar that went into the mouths of the Formosans who produced it.
I fought in the underground forces against the Japanese. I risked my life on the first day of the war until the last to bring you Chinese back here to Formosa. Now, I want to know why our own sugar is higher right here in Taiwan than it is in Shanghai.
The sugar corporation sold no sugar in Formosa. The sugar sold in Formosa was taken from stocks of private people who controlled some 500,000 tons.
The people of Taiwan use only 50,000 tons of sugar a year. Why is not sugar sold to us at a reasonable price?
Nanking, August 9th, 1946. Government control of the sale and distribution of sugar in Taiwan has been abolished. It was announced by the Office of the Governor General of Taiwan. With this move, the Chinese government has won.
After 50 years under the Japanese, the transition to the rule of the Chinese was painful, both for the people of Formosa and for the government of China. Constructive steps were taken by the Chinese.
Keelung Harbor here will become increasingly important. The excellent dockyards may become the main repairing center of Taiwan, and ships in need of repairs may even be towed here from Shanghai, 400 miles.
Yes, yes, it is good.
And the Taiwan municipal government is planning to raise $1 billion for the reconstruction of Anting Harbor.
Yes, but is it not equally or more important to stop the Chinese soldiers from looting the stocks we have? And is it not equally important to prevent our refineries and our railroads and power plants from falling into ruin?
You Formosans must know the task is enormous.
The Japanese have gone from the island of Formosa, and the Chinese have taken their place. Today, more than a year after the transfer, the Chinese have become aware of the enormous task that lies before them in Formosa. This awareness is reflected in the words of General Chen Yi.
If Taiwan falls short of our expectations, there will hardly be any hope for China as a whole.
Listening to the Pacific Story presented by the National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated independent stations to clarify events in the Pacific and to make understandable the cross currents of life in the Pacific Basin. For a reprint of this Pacific Story program, send 10 cents in stamps or coin to University of California Press, Berkeley, California. To repeat, for a reprint of this Pacific Story program, send 10 cents in stamps or coin to University of California Press, Berkeley, California. The Pacific Story is written and produced by Arnold Marquis. The music was scored and conducted by Henry Russell. Your narrator, Gain Whitman. Programs in this series of particular interest to servicemen and women are broadcast overseas through the worldwide facilities of the Armed Forces Radio Service. This program came to you from Hollywood and is heard in Canada over the facilities of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.